Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 2747 in the name of Kevin Stewart on mental health and wellbeing in primary care services. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function now or as soon as possible. And I call on the Minister to speak and move the motion for around 12 minutes. Please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and Happy New Year to you and all in the Chamber. I welcome the opportunity to open this debate on mental health and wellbeing in primary care services. Mental ill health is one of the major public health challenges in Scotland, and we know that the pandemic has had significant impact on mental health and wellbeing across Scotland, particularly for our children and young people. We will all have been affected in different ways, and we know that for too many people, the impact on their mental health will have been exacerbated by existing inequalities. Approximately one third of all GP consultations now have a mental health component. However, the increasing range and complexity of mental health presentations do not all fit existing pathways of care. We need to ensure that we have the right capacity and capability in place to provide the necessary assessment, care and support within primary care settings. This is essential to ensure people get the support they need when they need it. And last year, we published our Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan, which sets out how we intend to support mental health through the pandemic. We have further built on those commitments through the NHS Recovery Plan and our Programme for Government. And our work focuses just as much on supporting and creating conditions for everyone to have good mental health, mental wellbeing, as it does on transforming our mental health services. Our ambition is supported by our £120 million Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund, the single largest investment in mental health in the history of devolution. And the Scottish Budget, published on 9th December, continues record levels of investment, with direct funding for mental health in 2022-23 of over £290 million. That's a 6% increase on this year and a 139% increase on 2020-21. And by the end of this Parliament, we will increase direct mental health funding by 25% and ensure that 10% of all frontline NHS spend goes to mental health, with 1% directed specifically to children and young people services. I will indeed.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Grateful to the Minister for giving way. I'm also grateful for his assurances about his government's commitment to addressing the crisis in child and adolescent mental health care. But he will be aware of the Freedom of Information request published by my party over Christmas that shows that things are getting worse and not better. In fact, one young person had to wait 7 years for first-line treatment. How does he expect to clear down CAM's waiting times list by next year as his government ambition when we're still going backwards?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, we're still in the midst of the pandemic, and I think this is the most precarious time in the pandemic. We still have COVID cases. We have a situation where there are other winter pressures. And quite frankly, we have a situation where folk are tired. And that's why we are supporting our staff, and we are continuing to help where we can to ensure that we drive down those waiting times and waiting lists. They are unacceptable, and we will do all that we can to ensure that we get those down. I talked about the record investment in terms of transformational change, and I also want to talk, Presiding Officer, about the new multidisciplinary model which will deliver our manifesto commitment to provide 1,000 additional dedicated roles by 2026 to help to grow community mental health resilience and increase the use of social prescribing. This approach has the potential to be truly transformative, fundamentally changing the way services are delivered. It provides the opportunity for a truly person-centred service with more help for people when and where they need it. This multidisciplinary approach has been developed in partnership and will be central to changing how we deliver services. These newly funded roles could include mental health nurses, psychologists, peer support workers, occupational therapists and link workers. And this will increase the range of responses available in or around GP settings. It will no longer be the case that an individual can only be treated by their GP or through a referral to secondary services. To facilitate person-centred care, a range of professionals will be available to deliver a sustainable, timely and compassionate mental health service. We have heard directly from patients how support from different professionals can be life-changing. One patient in Ayrshire and Arran, following input from our occupational therapist, said, "My sleep pattern has improved and I feel like I am a different person." The Royal College of Occupational Therapists recognise that this support can prevent conditions from getting worse, especially where physical and mental ill health intertwine. Specifically, this approach looks to improving our nation's health, not just now, but in the long term, because it puts the needs of individuals first and, over time, will reduce pressure on our hospitals and acute services. This service will not operate in isolation either. As well as strengthening links with secondary care, they will sit within and link to broader community assets, such as addiction services, food banks, benefit support, and providing ongoing emotional support. This aspect of the services will be supported by every GP practice having access to a link worker, who will support mental wellbeing through good quality conversations, putting individuals at the centre of decision making about their care. I'll give way very briefly.
Dr. Gulhani.
Would the Minister agree that actually link workers should be already in every practice with the contracts that's already in place?
Minister.
Well, we already have link workers in practices, and this goes much, much further. And as I've said, this multifaceted approach, I think, will make a real difference, not only to GPs and practices, but more importantly, to patients across the country. The Alliance is also very supportive of this approach, recognising the role that community link workers and others in multidisciplinary teams can play to support improved mental health and wellbeing. We know that this pandemic has and will continue to have a significant effect on the mental health and wellbeing of our children and young people in Scotland. And I'd like to take a moment to highlight some of the work that we have progressed to improve services and support for young folks' mental health and wellbeing. We have already provided health boards with nearly £40 million to improve their child and adolescent mental health services over the lifetime of this Parliament. In addition, the mental health and wellbeing and primary care services will provide support, treatment and assessment across all demographics rather than targeted groups. And that will include children and young people. This will include early intervention and prevention to a range of people, which we know is vital in preventing the escalation of mental health needs. However, they will also support those with severe and complex mental health needs. Where more specialist input is required, they will be accessed by this service in partnership with a GP practice. To work towards our ambition for new mental health and wellbeing primary care services, £1.5 million has already been made available from the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund. And local planning guidance has also been developed and will be published tomorrow. Planning has been devolved to local groups who, through collaboration, communication and cooperation, are best placed to determine what is required to meet the needs of local people and communities. And while these services will play a vital role in COVID recovery, supporting and addressing mental health and wellbeing needs, which have increased significantly over the past 2 years, I am only too aware of the pressure that this pandemic continues to place on our frontline NHS services. So while we do not want to delay implementation of all of this, we have made it clear to stakeholders that we will work flexibly with them to support planning and avoid any additional or unnecessary pressures. Despite recent workforce expansion, we know that demand for mental health services continues to grow, which is why we are taking steps to continue to support and grow the workforce. We have invested, but recognise that recruitment continues to be challenging, which is why these services must be developed incrementally to 2026 and across a number of disciplines, as I've already mentioned. These services must provide additionality and must not replace existing capacity. These additional roles will be factored into the long-term mental health workforce plan developed in the first half of this Parliament, but we must act now to meet the growing demand for mental health support. Our intention is that the funding available will increase significantly year on year to support implementation, reaching up to an expected £40 million per annum by 2024-25. And by the end of the Parliament, this could be an investment of over £100 million, which should increase the mental health workforce substantially and change the way support is delivered in a truly transformational way. It will improve the experience of support and care provided in primary care through more rapid access to support within a setting that individuals know and trust. Our investment will be further complemented by the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund, announced in October last year, which will provide £15 million in community support for adults. The fund will provide opportunities to maximise links to further support options in local communities. And this will enable and empower people to tap into existing community assets, support and services. This fund builds upon the £50 million of funding this year through the Community Mental Health and Wellbeing Framework, which has enabled local authorities to provide over 230 new and enhanced community-based services for children and young people and their families and carers. I know, Presiding Officer, that members right across this chamber, regardless of our political differences, share our ambition to improve the nation's mental health and wellbeing. With mental health and primary care featuring as a centrepiece of most of the parties in this chamber's manifestos. And I look forward to today's debate and hearing the views of all in the chamber, including how folk can work with us to support the implementation of all of this. I would also like to take this opportunity, Presiding Officer, to thank key stakeholders who have contributed their time and energy to the development of the approach that I've outlined today. I also give my sincere thanks to those who have continued to provide essential services and support during this pandemic. Presiding Officer, I can't support the amendments lodged today. I have some sympathies for the amendment that was lodged by Mr Cole Hamilton, and we will ensure that we continue to recognise that there are workforce challenges. These are not unique to Scotland, and we have taken action to invest in mental health to address waiting times in the face of unprecedented demand and challenges. I also recognise...
You do need to be winding up now, Minister.
I'm almost there, Presiding Officer. I also recognise that this is one of the most difficult winters that our workforce has faced. Their wellbeing remains a key priority, and we'll overcome the challenges ahead if we look after our most valuable asset, the people who provide our services. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name, and I look forward to people's contributions this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. I can inform the Chamber that we are quite tight for time, so I would encourage members to stick to their time allocation. And with that, I call on Craig Hoy to speak to Move Amendment 2747.3 for around 8 minutes, please, Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I wish you and everyone present a happy new year. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome the debate into mental health in primary care in Scotland today. And to open, I would like to move the amendment in my name. At its core, this debate should be about the challenges that we face in mental health services. These challenges have undoubtedly been made more acute by the pandemic and by the restrictions that have been put in place to combat it. Scotland went into the public health crisis, however, with a pre-existing mental health crisis. People with mental health problems are forced to wait too long for help, particularly the young. So today we need to focus on the barriers to making progress. Deputy Presiding Officer, additional funding for mental health is welcome, and we have long advocated 10% of the NHS budget being directed towards mental health services, because these services are in crisis. Waiting times are too long, pathways are often too complex, medication rates remain too high, and too many people reach crisis point. And GP services, often the first point of contact, are severely overstretched, and I pay tribute to the work that GPs and all those working in the NHS and our mental health services are doing and will continue to do. But we should never lose sight of the fact that GPs are responsible for diagnosing, treating, monitoring and referring patients towards specialist services. And it is to GPs who patients return when they fail to access secondary mental health treatment or if that treatment fails. So while I recognise the huge pressures that GPs face, I do support Sam H's call for patients with mental health needs to be given priority for face-to-face appointments, wherever this is possible. The government should be well aware that 90% of people referred for psychological therapy should start treatment within 18 weeks, but that national standard has never been met. The 18-week waiting time targets for child and adolescent mental health services has also never been met. So that means that over 2,000 children are waiting over a year to access essential mental health services. Could the minister honestly imagine being 10 or 11 and being asked to wait over a year, or, as Alex Cole-Hamilton said, for up to 7 years for treatment for a complex condition that he does not fully understand? It is not just unfair, it is unsustainable and it is indefensible. Deputy Presiding Officer, following COVID, people are up to twice as likely to be experiencing anxiety, depression and high levels of psychological distress. This inevitably places more demand on all care and support services, community facilities across primary care and in secondary mental health facilities too. The system is squeezed to crisis point and over 1,000 vacancies for mental health nurses remain unfilled, and nearly 100 more consultant psychiatrists are needed across the service. The Royal College of Nursing says that we need a long-term, fully funded workforce plan for mental health services across primary and acute care. The Royal College of GPs in Scotland warns that 71% of its members saw mental health-related presentations increase a lot during the pandemic. And can also make an appeal. Mental health problems are widespread. They affect people of all ages and all backgrounds. So when we debate poor mental health, we all too often fall back on jargon. We make the services seem inaccessible. The Minister talks frequently about lived experience. So what is lived experience? It's people who this morning took a drink rather than a walk because the world outside seems too bleak. Children, often young girls, retreating to their rooms to self-harm, starting with pins and pencils before moving to knives. People suffering stress and anxiety at the prospect of doing everyday things. Adults treated in secure mental health facilities for their own safety or the safety of their partners and children. And let us never forget those who feel there is no other way out. Sometimes they are failed by the system, who take their own lives. That is the reality of the lived experience for those individuals, their family, their friends and their colleagues. As a report published by the BMA and Health and Social Care Scotland published last July stated, more work needs to be done to demystify services. It adds the current terminology used within the system is often a barrier to asking for help. Fundamentally, Deputy Presiding Officer, this government needs to address the barriers and the blockages, the barriers and the blockages to accessing services. The complex terminology, people being forced to tell painful stories time and time again, the locked doors, the long waiting lists, the rejected referrals. And I'll give way to the Minister.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mr Hoy for giving way. During my short time in this role, I've spent a lot of time talking to folks with lived experience. And I actually don't disagree with Mr Hoy around about the terminology and some of the difficulties that there are in accessing services. And this is one of the reasons why we are making this investment, so it is easier for folks to talk to people and to access those services. And I hope that together across this Parliament, we can all do as much as we possibly can to destigmatise mental health and to ensure that we get rid of some of the jargon and the barriers that Mr Hoy
has talked about. An important point, but not a brief intervention. Mr Hoy.
I thank the Minister for that not so brief intervention. I very much agree with him that if community link workers can act almost as translators between the practitioners and public and patients, then they will be doing a huge service. I think we need to focus also on the multidisciplinary teams that will be created, because this is to be welcomed and encouraged. But many of these blockages that we've talked about result from poor levels of recruitment into existing posts. And while I welcome the Government's commitment to the expansion of mental health link workers, I do wonder where these will be recruited from. By 2026, every GP practice will have access to a mental health and wellbeing service, but this will require over 1,000 new recruits. Now, I look forward to finding out more from the Government as to how they will find that capacity. So we need not just to focus on retention and recruitment, we must also make sure that we avoid redeployment. The borrow from Peter to pay Paul approach to staffing across the NHS is ultimately unsustainable, as the Royal College of Psychiatrists has conceded. We also need to address the issue of staff morale. As Alex Cole-Hamilton's motion refers to, staff are worn out and burnt out. We have asked everything of them and more, and urgent action is needed there also, Minister. And it is also time to tackle the postcode lottery in mental health services to ensure that these new services are fully defined, accessible wherever possible around the clock, and that they are consistent and comprehensive. Fundamentally, we need to make sure that we tackle those low-level mental health problems, problems which, left unchecked, often only escalate, sometimes to crisis solutions. According to Public Health Scotland, socially disadvantaged people have an advanced risk and an increased risk of developing mental health issues. So we need to ensure that these multidisciplinary professional teams are plugged into the primary care process and that they're qualified in areas such as relationships, family circumstances, the effects of poor housing, disability and unemployment, and that they can provide support on people's personal finance issues, drug and alcohol misuse, grief and trauma, problems with prescription drugs and other forms of dependency. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is, I believe, cross-party consensus that we must do more to tackle the mental health crisis that we face. And as we've all seen from the helpful briefings that we have been received in recent days from among the Royal Colleges, charities and community groups, there is no lack of support and no poverty of ideas as we set about doing this. The challenge for this Government is to take this crisis seriously and to address it urgently, to get the new and additional trained staff
in place now, Mr. Hoy,
to tackle the underlying causes of poor mental health. That should not be too much to ask. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. I now call on Carol Mochan to speak to and move Amendment 2747.1 for around 6 minutes, Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to open this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour. As a party, we have been at the forefront of arguing for a better settlement for people in need of mental health support. And with the pandemic further stretching the resources of our NHS, there is no better time than now to discuss this crucial issue. I welcome the fact mental health is receiving more attention, and it appears we're beginning to turn a corner in recognising its vital importance to the wellbeing of the country. But let me be clear, recognition on its own will not push the needle forward. It will require considerable and targeted investment over a long period of time, with significant investment in staffing levels. We need to match the increased funding in other parts of the UK. And I am going to be honest. We need a minister and a government who place the needs of others before the need to spend time in this chamber to, quite frankly, pat themselves on the back. Our staff and those in need of the service deserve better. They deserve better than this self-congratulatory government motion placed before us today. Scotland's mental health provision is well below that which taxpayers deserve and puts undue pressure on staff who are working day and night to provide a world-class service. I think it is fair to say that for the most part, the record of this Scottish Government on the issue has been dismal, and that the general public recognise this, and their perception is that mental health is treated as a second-class consideration. There are so... Yes, briefly,
Minister.
Please.
I have to say that mental health has been a priority for this government since coming to power, and there has been significant investment. Since 2007, psychiatric consultants across all specialities in NHS Scotland has increased by 23.22%. Mental health nursing workforce has increased by 34% since 2007.
Thank you, Minister.
Significant investment.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you. I am going to address these issues. There are so many personal stories we have heard many of them, and in particular the experiences of young people stand out. They are often in pain and in many cases very lost with nowhere to turn. And what do they face? Waiting lists, long waiting lists. That first appointment and continued treatment could be the difference between life and death for some, but it is coming far too late in many cases. Evidence to this health committee repeatedly shows long waits with no community alternatives or basic local service provision. Young people and mental health organisations have repeatedly told us in community committee that shrinking provision of local services is impacting on wellbeing. This government's response is to cut local government funding again. There has to be recognition on the benches behind the government. Surely this has to change, and has to change rapidly.
John Mason.
Is the member arguing that the NHS should have a cut in its budget to give more to local government?
Carol Mochen.
This member is fed up with the government backbenches using this as an excuse to not properly fund services. This has to be recognised. Now, to return to NHS services, Scottish Labour's amendment notes there is 18-week waiting time targets for CAMHS, and yet this has not once been met. And on top of that, almost 2,000 children, we have heard, and young people are waiting on lists. They are waiting over a year, over a year. I don't think we would leave people waiting a year if they had serious physical injuries. So why then does the minister not address this? Beyond the individuals who are directly affected, these figures tell the story of thousands of extended families, and they speak to us about this. They are constantly worried about their loved ones. At the bottom of so much of this is the continued underinvestment, and the thought that the government's motion papers over some of the cracks. It's not anywhere near enough to turn the ship around and address the very real issues of staff shortages. And the truth is, only this government can take the blame for this. It is their lack of planning that has resulted in such failures on our staff and the workforce. Our NHS staff deserve so much better. I asked the minister, but he already knows because the previous speaker has mentioned it, there are over 1,000 vacancies for mental health nurses and almost 100 consultant psychiatrist vacancies across Scotland. Can he tell us now how many of these vacancies will be filled? And over the next 12 months, will these vacancies be filled? Staff shortages are undermining our efforts to improve services, get people experiencing poor mental health the right treatment and support the well-being of staff. But these things do not seem to be a priority. It takes time and long-term planning to get them in place. A quick pat on the back is what is preferred. Short-termism is not going to cut it. The Scottish Government's own target to recruit 800 mental health workers by 2022 looks like it's going to be missed. 100 of these positions have not even been created. And let's be honest, it wasn't even an ambitious target. These statistics really do not make positive reading for us at all. But there is an alternative. Scottish Labour believe that every GP practice should have access to mental health professionals to support patients close to home and reduce pressures on GPs who are struggling to deal with the growing caseload that they have. In order to do this, it is our contention that mental health funding should be increased to at least 11% of the NHS budget. Doing so would signal to young people in particular that this government is taking mental health seriously. In closing, Presiding Officer, we can see a consistent pattern developing where the government come to the chamber and announce targets designed to address long-term problems. These targets are missed and then they simply start the cycle again.
Need to close now.
I will, but although in this case they also allocate time to congratulate themselves.
No, you need to conclude now.
It's politics by press release. I move the motion in Scottish Labour's name, in my name for Scottish Labour.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochen. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak to move amendment 2747.2 for 6 minutes, please, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm grateful to the Government for making time for this debate. debate, because Scotland still faces a national mental health crisis. It's been defined as a crisis by this chamber on no less than two occasions in backing amendments in my name and the name of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. Presiding Officer, that mental health crisis is experienced in front lines right across our public sector, in our schools, in our prisons, in our hospitals, in our GP surgeries. It is characterised by the same things: unmet need, crises which could have been averted because early warning signs were not acted on sufficiently, and people facing monstrous waiting times. There is an acute mental health problem in Scotland. We know that. And we know that one in four people will suffer from a serious mental health condition at some point in their life. But just like physical health, mental health and the way it is maintained and falters has a huge impact on everyone's life. And just like physical health, when small problems aren't spotted or treated, they become acute. That is why mental health should be regarded with the same priority as physical health is. I think Carol Mochan was absolutely right. You wouldn't expect somebody to wait a year with a severe physical injury. That is why it should be prioritised in the same way. And Scottish Liberal Democrats have long fought for that. Such a fight has secured over £145 million in the last budget for mental health. The pandemic has taken its toll. It separated us from loved ones. It's disrupted our livelihoods, made us worry about the very fabric of our community. So it's no wonder then that the pandemic itself has left so many of us with mental health taking a turn for the worse. And the Royal College of Psychiatrists has reported that people are twice as likely to experience anxiety, depression, high levels of psychological stress than before COVID-19. Whereas the Scottish Association for Mental Health also found that 8 in 10 GPs thought that we are at the cusp of this new hidden pandemic, and mental ill health was set to increase as a direct result. Novelist Charlotte Bronte once wrote that if life is a battle, may we all be enabled to fight it well. Presiding Officer, despite the growing need for access to mental health services and the valiant efforts of our healthcare services, those battling with their mental health in this country are not enabled to fight that battle well. 20% of adults have sought help for their mental health were not seen within the 18-week waiting period. And in 2014, the SNP set itself a target on mental health waiting times that has never, ever been achieved. Furthermore, research conducted by my own party, and I've referenced this in an intervention to Kevin Stewart, found that hundreds of children have had to wait more than 2 years to receive first-line treatment from child and adolescent mental health services. And as I said earlier, one young person had to wait 7 years for that treatment to begin. That is a scandal. Opening up about your mental health is a vulnerable act, and it is a remarkably brave one, regardless of where it takes place. And it should be met with a reassurance and, most importantly, with help. People should only have to tell their story once. Primary care providers in places like GPs are so often used as a place to seek such help, but already existing pressures on staff have been exacerbated by the pandemic, which have moved appointments online, shortened those same appointments, and reduced the amount of face time that people can have together. These factors make it even harder for people to open up and for staff to spot warning signs. It is clear, absolutely crystal clear, that there needs to be radical action to tackle this issue and to ensure that everyone has access to consistent treatment and if and when they need it. And while I do welcome where progress has been made and the ambition set by the government, we've talked about the ambition to clear down CAM's waiting lists by 2023, my party's campaigns have been listened to. The policies the government currently have on offer simply don't go far enough, and I'm very concerned that we may artificially seek to meet targets like the CAM's one by parking young people on medication. This is why the Scottish Liberal Democrats have been campaigning for more mental health professional places to work in primary care providers. We agree with the Labour amendment on citing those mental health care professionals in GPs, not just link workers, people who can offer talking therapies on site, to implement a mental health first aider strategy in every workplace, and to increase the number of walk-in services at mental health emergency services. Presiding Officer, there is a desperate need to train more staff. Of that, there is no doubt. When surveyed, almost half of the students said they were experienced serious psychological issues and they feel like they are not getting help for. Yet one in eight specialist positions in child and adolescent mental health positions currently lie vacant. This is why we have previously called for doubling the number of specialist psychiatrists who can answer this deeply unmet need. We must also make sure that we have a large and strong workforce across Scotland to ensure quality of services delivered to anyone, wherever they are, because we know that there are issues of rurality which compound that. But we also need to do more to retain the staff that we do have by making sure they're not overloaded, that they have good working conditions, they know when their breaks are coming, and that their well-being is protected as well. We know the impact that this can have. I have reminded this chamber before of my constituent, Andy Cunningham, who is a paramedic in emergency care, who talked very bravely about the time that he realised he needed help when fishing another suicide victim out of the river. He just felt entirely empty, entirely devoid of feeling, and realised that he was struggling. He put his hand up and received some help, but he is one of the lucky ones. We owe our emergency care and frontline primary care staff an immense debt of gratitude, and their mental health is suffering as well. I'll conclude by saying this, Presiding Officer. The NHS is one of our most vital services, is our most vital service. It is life-saving, but it is also on life support, and nowhere is that more evident in the waiting list for first-line mental health treatment. So I, once again, move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Cole-Hamilton. We now move to the open debate, and I call James Dornan, who will be followed by Sue Webber. Mr Dornan joins us online for in 6 minutes. Mr Dornan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This is an extremely important get the opportunity to speak in support of the motion to Kevin Stewart. And that's why I'm sorry that before I get into my speech, I really have to ask the Minister to inform me during his closing speech of what budget proposals Labour made to increase funding on mental health this year, last year, or any year since 2007. Or did Ms Morgan give you the address of where they keep the magic money tree? Labour do nobody any good by pretending there's an easy solution to the problem of staffing and mental health. I know that the Scottish Government has been keen to make progress for some time in improving the situation for those who have been struggling with their mental health, and note the progress that's been made to date with the introduction of community link support workers in many areas of the country. As someone who's seen his own mental health suffer during the pandemic, I think it's vitally important to acknowledge the mental health challenges posed to us all by COVID. I'm fortunate to have a partner that stays with me and family close by who understand my moods and depressions when things get bad. But there are so many people who are unable to make use of their regular family support networks and experience isolation from those close to them, whether it be geographical or through restrictions on visiting in hospital or care settings. With the Omicron variant, which is more easily transmissible than ever, we just can't abandon all restrictions at the time. It's this difficult balance of combating the threat posed by COVID at the same time as the need to acknowledge and recognise the challenges of maintaining good mental health that's clearly a major driver behind the implementation of this policy, a policy which marks a step change in the treatment of mental health in Scotland. In 2021, the Scottish Government announced the establishment of the £120 million Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund. This is largely focused on the provision of community-based support. This huge pool of funding is what is enabling the expansion of mental health services to include 1,000 new roles. And I don't think it'd be hyperbolic to say that the additional mental health challenges posed in the wake of COVID may not be fully felt for a generation, but I'm really pleased that the Scottish Government is taking action now to do what it can to mitigate future mental health problems which we will face alongside the ones that we're facing just now. The addition of these 1,000 new roles in primary care settings will mark one of the biggest investments in the mental health of the nation in decades. It will see the development and implementation of innovative solutions at local levels, allowing teams to work together across multiple different disciplines to enhance the care received by our citizens when they need it the most. I was pleased to see the recommendations of the 2017 Mental Health Strategy begin to come to fruition. As someone who's advocated for better and more accessible mental health services from the beginning of my time and as an MSP, I see this as a large step in the right direction from the Scottish Government. I know it's not a panacea to all of the mental health problems that my fellow Scots will be experiencing, but it's a big step in the right direction and one that should be welcomed by all parties in this chamber. Presiding Officer, Public Health Scotland estimate that adults living in the most deprived areas are approximately twice as likely to have common mental health problems as those in the least deprived areas. And this is something that we must address when looking at ways to improve the mental health of our nation. There are numerous reasons people in the more deprived areas suffer more often from mental health issues. It's often to do with the frequency in which they have to deal with problems, that they don't have the means or support to deal with, which unsurprisingly causes massive amounts of stress in their lives. Few of these issues include poor housing, family problems, unemployment, childhood adversity and chronic health conditions. But behind most, if not all of these, lies the curse of poverty. Clearly, mental health inequality exists all over Scotland, but given what I've just highlighted, I would welcome any assurances the Minister can give in summing up that the help provided will be specifically targeted, where possible, at the more deprived areas of Scotland. As the MSP for Glasgow-Cathcart, I have a number of areas within the constituency that have a large amount of mental health sufferers in it. And unfortunately, last year, I received an alarming amount of reports of young men committing suicide in one area of my constituency. We all know that too often horrific events such as this happen in areas of unemployment, sickness and benefit recipients. The last straw for some families is the loss of any part of the meagre household income they receive. That is why, without saying this would have been the only issue, or, and I promise this, trying to make any political capital on it, I urge my Conservative colleagues to lobby their government to reinstate the £20 universal credit. It may not be much to us, but it can make a difference to a young mother, a young parent with a child or children to feed, or someone being able to both eat and heat instead of having to choose between the two. And that's why I'm keen to ensure those in deprived areas are offered the most benefit possible from this increase in staffing for mental health services. It's where I believe it would do the most good for my constituents, the City of Glasgow and our country as a whole, as well as those people who are already often having to negotiate so many precarious aspects of their life. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I warmly welcome the actions of the Scottish Government in relation to mental health and recognise that the improvements to our mental health services will be transformational to the lives of many who have not been able to access the help that they needed in the past. I appreciate the commitment of Kevin Stewart, our Mental Wellbeing and Social Care Minister, who has worked hard on what is a particularly challenging grief at the moment, and I'm proud to see real concrete action being taken by this government on what has been a long-standing problem in our society, and I look forward to seeing the new community-based support being put in place. This will benefit many people in the area that I represent, and will hopefully be able to mitigate some of the health inequalities present in those more deprived areas of which mental health inequality has always played a large part.
Thank you, Mr Dornan. I now call on Sue Webber to be followed by Paul McLennan. Again, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Primary care services are often the first point of contact for people experiencing mental health problems. But improving mental health and wellbeing is a major public health challenge, as we've heard today. This is partly because the underlying issues are complex and people's needs are different. All public services have an important role to play in supporting wellbeing and tackling the social and economic factors that contribute to mental health problems. In 2021, mental health issues were the primary reason for time off work, outstripping COVID. Poor mental health accounted for 19% of all lost working time across the country, while confirmed cases of COVID represented 16%. In addition, mental health troubles were the most common cause of lost working time in nearly every industry in the UK, with absences averaging at least three times longer than COVID-related reasons. Evidence suggests that mental health problems in childhood and adolescence have a significant impact on mental health and education, and on the ability to find and sustain employment. The COVID pandemic has had a detrimental effect on children and young people's mental health and wellbeing, some evidence that this will also affect their attainment. 36% of children and young people with learning disabilities have a diagnosable psychiatric disorder. 40% of looked after children in Scotland aged between 5 and 17 were assessed as having at least one mental disorder. 95% of 16 to 20-year-olds in custody have at least one mental health problem. And as we've heard already, children living in low-income households are three times more likely to suffer mental health problems than their more affluent peers. Yet despite these alarming statistics, more children and young people are waiting over 18 weeks to start treatment in specialist CAMHS, up from 26% in 2017-18 to 33% in 2021. While those waiting more than a year for treatment trebled between March 2020 and March 2021. The National Improvement Framework is the Scottish Government's key plan that sets out four priorities for education, These priorities include children and young people's health and wellbeing. However, there is a lack of data to assess the wellbeing of children and young people who are learners at school. And if we cannot assess whether a national priority is being achieved, it is impossible to know what is working and what needs to change. At Health, Social Care and Sport Committee yesterday, we heard from Mary Glasgow, the Chief Executive of Children First. She spoke at length about the challenges families face when their children need support. We heard about the importance of having good person-centred services. This is something the Scottish Government frequently mentions, but rarely delivers. Good person-centred services should provide a space to really listen and understand the needs of the family and the young person, not what the agency can spare to offer. Mary Glasgow told us of family wellbeing teams and the success these services have had when social and family relationships are fractured and young people suffer with anxiety, self-harm tendencies and eating disorders. When they get their GP appointment, they are often told that CAM services are the only option. But these family wellbeing teams offer quick and early help. They often remove the requirement for CAMS assessment and provide a safe space for families and young people to be heard. These teams are effective and allow the time needed to build relationships between the professionals and the families. Unfortunately, funding issues often make it difficult to replicate the family wellbeing teams across the country. Those were her words. And language used by our professionals often contributes to the stigma, and we've heard that from Ms. Mochan earlier. And we must start using human language. Often there is shame and guilt felt by those who need assistance, and being referred to a service contributes to that feeling. Shame, stigma and guilt must be removed. Those who need assistance have done nothing wrong. They are entitled to support and help. And this must be delivered with respect, kindness and compassion. Yet how can a workforce that has reached burnout deliver that compassionate care when they themselves are facing periods of stress and anxiety? Patients and carers are both at the end of their tether. For once, I want this SNP government to accept that things were bad long before COVID. We must stop using COVID to justify our poorly performing services. We need to start making changes now. Our parents and young people deserve better mental health support. There is so much good practice going on across the country. So let's find it, let's fund it, and let's replicate it. Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Webber. I now call on Paul McLennan to be followed by Monica Lennon. Again, 6 minutes, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Kevin Stewart and the Scottish Government for bringing forward this debate this afternoon? I recently held my first members' debate celebrating World Mental Health Day in October of this year, so it's great to see this issue being debated again. The first line in the motion states that the Parliament recognises the importance of improving capability and capacity for mental health assessment, care and support within primary care settings. And obviously this is in the context as we recover from the pandemic. The commitment to expand mental health and wellbeing primary care services is of course being supported by the £120 million Mental Health Recovery and Renewable Fund. And that obviously is very welcome. So why is it important? We've heard a few members talk about this today, and we've all been briefed by various organisations. The Mental Health Foundation shows that long-term inequalities continue to drive many mental health problems across Scotland. Children who live in the poorest households are four times more likely to have poorer mental health wellbeing than those in the highest income households. Yeah?
Craig Hoy.
Thank you. I thank the member for giving way. In the intervention with Alex Douglas Cole-Hamilton, the minister said that the CAMS delay was largely down to COVID and winter pressures. But the government first said they would address CAMS waiting times in 2018. That predates COVID. Surely these issues are deeper rooted than that, and that the government have failed in the past to tackle them.
Paul McLean.
Obviously, that's been mentioned by Alex Cole-Hamilton. I'm sure the minister will address that issue in his winding up. So, as I said, it's four times more likely to have poorer mental well-being. And I think poverty is a major driver, and that's one of the things we can't forget. We need to double our efforts on child poverty. The Scottish Health Survey for 2020 also found that 1 in 10 adults had 2 or more symptoms of depression, while a similar proportion, 13%, had 2 or more symptoms of anxiety. And just this year, in February 2021, among Scottish 18 to 24-year-olds, 50% felt lonely over the last 2 weeks because of the pandemic. The Scottish adult rate was 29%. The Royal College of Psychiatrists welcomes the investment and additional staffing proposed in the motion today. They also state that the proposals can take a step closer to a no-wrong-door health and social care service that can provide the right care in the right place at the right time. And I think it's really important that we look at where we can deliver these in the local environment. We need to continue to invest in local primary care services where the needs would be better met by holistic, community-based treatment options. I want to touch on the role of social prescribing. We already have the Scottish Social Prescribing Network set up just now, and I know Marie Todd meets with them often. And previous studies have shown that the social prescribing initiatives can reduce accident and emergency attendances and patient admissions and can significantly improve feelings of social connectedness and overall mental well-being. The Mental Health Foundation in their briefing asked that the Scottish Government invest in community health services through a rapid expansion of social prescribing, exercise referral schemes and peer support and cognitive behavioural therapy. The proposals, as we've heard before, for multidisciplinary primary care, mental health and wellbeing services defined by local resource to meet local need is, of course, a positive step. The range of professionals can provide the skills and experiences needed to provide comprehensive care as well as connections to social supports. And on link workers, the Scottish Government's commitment to recruit 1,000 additional mental health link workers is in the 2022-23 programme for Government, and that, of course, is welcome. We've heard discussions around about GP practices having access to a community link worker, and I think that's really, really important. This is a vital means of ensuring that patients who present with symptoms of a mild to moderate mental health problem are given the opportunity to participate in community-based programmes. Local need should determine the allocation of newly recruited link workers, and it's maybe a point I'll ask the Minister to address in his winding up. The existing social community link worker network could also be used to look at existing community link networks to look at evaluation, training and measuring outcomes. Link workers should also have in-depth and up-to-date understanding of the range of relevant mental wellbeing programmes that are available across their own GP catchment area. And I think one of the key things, obviously, I'm talking about my constituency in East Lothian, we need to look at that. That's also available in rural areas, for example. And expectations of care, we need to ensure that we have clearly defined expectations of what should be available and metrics of success for these services and their staff. These can help ensure the quality of care and support that is there, regardless of the model of delivery. Now, this applies to link workers' roles as well, who also need a defined training pathway. We've had a few members talk about the issue and about recruitment, and again, on additional posts identified. Yesterday, we had a debate around about labour shortages in our economy, and this is obviously relevant to talk about this issue as well. We need a unified approach. We need to work alongside other services and professions in mental health. We need to have the correct balance between redeployment and the creation of new staff capacity. We need to work closely with third community and health sectors even further. Presiding officer, we need also to support those with severe pre-existing mental health conditions. The quality of access for those with more severe and complex mental health conditions need the access to the right care and support through their GP must be a priority. This includes being able to access the social supports and connections proposed to enable them to participate in economic and social activities. And in connections to specialist care, this is also critical with continued engagement by GPs with secondary care settings to ensure timely access to the care patients need. This care must continue to be properly resourced and staffed, reflecting that there will continue to be those with severe, complex and enduring conditions who will need specialist care interventions. We need to ensure additional support and training will be provided to enable those new services and link workers to provide support and signposting to those with severe mental health. This morning I just met with the carers of East Lothian, and that issue was talked about quite extensively, signposting, and I think that's a really important matter, looking at local solutions for local people. Presiding officer, in conclusion, this investment by the Scottish Government is very much welcomed. This investment can make a real difference to many families and ensure people live life as full as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call on Monica Lennon to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick. Ms Lennon, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, it is always good to talk about mental health and wellbeing. What people in the country really need the government to do is to take bold and urgent action to address fundamental system failure. I must use some of my time today to address breaking news that affects my constituents. NHS Lanarkshire declared a code black emergency on the 22nd of October last year, meaning services are operating at the highest level of risk. Clearly not a sustainable solution. I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on the 9th of December, asking him to meet with me and other Lanarkshire MSPs as a matter of urgency to brief us on his plans to reduce the risk to our constituents. 12 weeks on, I don't have the words to describe how badly the situation has declined in Lanarkshire. It's off the scale, and today the Health Board has advised that GP practices have been instructed to move to a managed suspension of services, which will continue for 4 weeks. However, given the code black has already gone on for 3 months, it's hard to have confidence that the Scottish Government has a proper plan to get out of this crisis beyond shutting down more services, cancelling operations, and keeping people in despair. People like my constituent, Liz Barry from East Kilbride, whose mental health is in tatters because she lives with constant chronic pain and is expected to wait 3 years for a vital pain relief injection. Now, Liz has already tried to take her own life. That's how serious this matter is. And it's extremely distressing for me and my team that the phone number that we hand out most often is 116 123. That's the number for Samaritans Scotland. Now, I'm grateful to all the Samaritans volunteers for providing a life-saving helpline 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. But I feel sad and I feel angry that people are contemplating suicide because they cannot get NHS treatment and have lost all hope. So I return to this grim announcement from NHS Lanarkshire today, which cautions that only the most urgent and time-critical cases will be responded to. How are urgent and time-critical being defined? Those who can afford it are going private, but what about everyone else? And what worries me greatly, and I hope it is an oversight, is that arrangements for people with mental health concerns have not even been mentioned in the correspondence and press release that's been published by NHS Lanarkshire today. So the Minister must give a cast-iron guarantee this afternoon that mental health is not being deprioritised in NHS Lanarkshire or, frankly, anywhere else. Laying everything at the door of COVID is not an answer either. We all know that mental health services were in a really bad way before the pandemic. What we need is transformative system change, and I make no apology again for drawing government and Parliament's attention to a petition spearheaded by my constituent, Karen McEwen, following the death of her partner, Luke Henderson, to suicide, a matter that I highlighted in Paul McLaren's debate on World Mental Health Day last year. The death of Luke Henderson was a tragic loss that could have been avoided if we had mental health services that functioned properly. Karen's petition has already moved MSPs in committee session to tears, but she doesn't look for our sympathy, presiding officer. She wants an independent review of mental health services, and I appeal to the Minister to agree to this. I also want to acknowledge the thousands of people living in care homes whose mental and emotional well-being has declined during the pandemic due to isolation and loneliness. Now, we know the SNP promised before the election to give effect to Anne's Law. Now, Andrew has sadly passed away, and her family and the Care Home Relatives Scotland group want to know when Anne's Law will be implemented. Family caregivers must be part of the care plan if we are serious about mental health and well-being. We all know and appreciate healthcare workers. They do their best with the time and resource available to them, and at times their own mental health and well-being takes a battering. The Minister must act to prevent burnout, exhaustion and PTSD from becoming the norm in our public services. So like my colleague from Scottish Labour, Carol Mockin, I too am frustrated by the motion in front of us today. For too long, SNP ministers have been complacent and taken a sticking plaster approach to mental health services while people continue to fall through the cracks. It is unacceptable that the government's 18-week waiting time targets for CAMHS have never been met. Unacceptable that there are currently almost 2,000 children and young people on the waiting list who've had to wait over a year to begin treatment. and unacceptable that there are currently over 1,000 vacancies for mental health nurses and almost 100 consultant psychiatrist vacancies. So our amendment injects some reality into this debate. SNP ministers have failed to take workforce planning seriously, and their target of recruiting 800 mental health workers is at risk. Presiding officer, missed targets and broken promises have consequences. I support the Scottish Labour amendment, and I urge the government to accept Karen McKeown's petition as nothing short of an independent review of mental health services and complete system change will do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Lennon. I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Gillian Mackay again. 6 minutes, Mr Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The COVID-19 pandemic continues to place additional strain on our NHS, including on its mental health services. We know that the pandemic continues to have a significant impact on the mental well-being of many in our communities. So I welcome that the Scottish Government has provided £18 million of dedicated funding to help respond to the specific mental health challenges of the pandemic. In Dundee, there have for some time now been calls, which I have backed, for a service in the city centre that can support people, particularly at a time of crisis. And I'm really encouraged that my city is now delivering upon that ambition, with a site having been identified for a new community wellbeing centre, which will be always open and will provide an immediate, compassionate response to anyone who considers themselves in need of mental health support. I'm looking forward to seeing this vital service up and running and pay tribute to Phil Welsh and his wife for campaigning for this service. Presiding Officer, as we've heard, the SNP has committed to increasing Scottish Government investment in mental health by at least 25%, ensuring that by the end of this Parliament, 10% of our frontline NHS budget will be invested in mental health services. I welcome Scottish Government's plan to build on the success of its Community Link Worker programme to ensure that every GP practice in the country has access to a dedicated mental wellbeing link worker, creating a network of 1,000 additional dedicated staff who can help grow community mental health resilience and help direct social prescribing. This will ensure that people get the support that they need, when they need it and where they need it. In primary care across Dundee, the new Patient Assessment Management and Liaison Service, PAMS, in primary care aims to enable without barrier access to a mental health specialist right across our city. PAMS places mental health specialists directly within GP practices and encourages people concerned about their mental health and wellbeing to book appointments directly without having to see their GP first. Social prescribing link workers are also supporting practices across the city. As of August, I understand there are 7 GP practices with full access to PAMS and 4 practices with partial access to PAMS, with further expansions planned. I want to take this opportunity to also pay tribute to some of the charities and third sector organisations who are playing a vital role in improving mental health and wellbeing within local communities across Dundee. So the Lochee Community Hub in my constituency provides mental health support as well as drug and alcohol support, child and family groups and one-to-one services. The Hub has been supported by funding from the Scottish Government's Investment in Communities Fund and is an invaluable community space with staffing supporting the local Lochee community. At the Lynch, Street Soccer's new Change Centre is providing football-themed training and personal development opportunities for socially disadvantaged groups from across Scotland, including from those in my constituency. Street Soccer are doing incredible work in supporting people to address issues such as mental health, drug and alcohol use, loneliness and isolation. Presiding Officer, the Dundee Fairness Commission brought together members from the public, voluntary, community, private and academic sectors, including those who have lived experience of poverty and inequality. Since 2015, the Commission has gathered evidence and worked tirelessly to identify solutions to improve local communities across Dundee. One of the areas they identified as being beneficial to mental health and wellbeing was safe access to green space. In 2019, I was pleased to help launch green health prescriptions in Dundee as part of the Green Health Partnership. 3 GP practices piloted the programme, which has since been expanded further into primary and selected secondary care services across the city. The initiative aims to bring about a step change in the use of nature-based solutions to deliver health outcomes. as part of social prescribing, aiming to allow NHS healthcare professionals to connect patients with free outdoor interventions delivered and supported by the third sector. I also want to highlight the important work of the award-winning Tayview Community Garden, which now has 25 plots and helps to connect the community and with local organisations and charities. Preparations are underway at the adjacent site to create Dundee's first wee forest, a partnership between Dundee University's Botanic Gardens, a local primary healthcare provider, local primary schools, and is funded by Nature Scot. Wellbeing Works Dundee works closely with individuals and partner organisations to grow food at the community garden. They've also recently launched their community toolbox, which allows members to hire tools and equipment from their library. This ranges from tools for home improvements to camping equipment. The Fruit Bowls community project at Lochie Park in the heart of my constituency has transformed a former bowling green to a community growing project and is another example of repurposing green space in Dundee for the benefit of local communities' health and well-being. Presiding Officer, I want to also take the opportunity to thank the parish nurses at the Steeple Church, the Hot Chocolate Trust, Positive Steps, Feeling Strong, the Dundee Carer Centre, Dundee Contemporary Arts and the City's Rep Theatre, and the many other organisations who continue to work tirelessly to improve the mental well-being of my constituents. Finally, Presiding Officer, I want to recognise the two Andy Mans clubs which now operate in Dundee and a women's club also planned. The club regularly organises walks and talk sessions and everyone is welcome to join. Almost 38,000 people attended the Andy Mans Club across the UK last year, including many in my constituency. Presiding Officer, charities such as this are integral to tackling stigma around mental health, an area which I hope across the Chamber we can all work to tackle. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Greens believe that everyone who needs mental health support should have quick and easy access to it. We must place mental health at the heart of our healthcare system to ensure it has parity with physical health. And part of that is ensuring that people can get support and treatment when they need it. Too many people are waiting too long for treatment. The number of referrals to psychological therapies are now back to pre-pandemic levels and services are struggling to meet demand. We need to make it as easy as possible for people to access mental health support if we're committed to prevention and early intervention. We need to provide an alternative to acute treatment so that people are receiving the most appropriate support, but also so that they are not sitting on a waiting list while their mental health worsens. We know that the pandemic has had a devastating impact on mental health. People have struggled financially, they've lost loved ones, they've been isolated while in lockdown or shielding. We should not underestimate the effect of this collective trauma, which will continue to take its toll for many years to come. For most people, making an appointment with a GP is the first step towards getting help for mental health problems. And like Monica Lennon, I am concerned with the issues facing NHS Lanarkshire at the moment. According to the Royal College of GPs, approximately one third of all consultations in GP practices have a mental health component. General practice teams have already been providing mental health support to a large portion of the population, and as health professionals embedded within the community, they are well placed to do so, particularly to individuals who may not require acute or specialist treatment. According to a recent RCGP survey, 94% of GPs who responded agreed that since the beginning of the pandemic, the number of patients presenting with mental health problems has increased. The GP workforce is under pressure like never before, and this is impacting GPs' ability to help patients seeking mental health support. A report produced by SAMH found that while there have been very positive examples of participants receiving support from GPs, the pressures of the pandemic have negatively affected some people's experiences of accessing mental health support, with many describing difficulty in accessing appointments due to high demand. We cannot leave people struggling without the help they need, but we also cannot expect existing services to meet the surging demand. We need to expand the number of mental health professionals working within communities. This is why the Scottish Greens and the Scottish Government have committed to ensure that by the end of this parliamentary session, every GP practice has a link worker and access to an assigned community-based mental health clinician. This will help to ensure that patients can access mental health support as quickly as possible, also that they see the most appropriate person. If treatment is truly to be person-centred, we also need to see a diverse mix of mental health professionals in primary care, so people can see the right person at the right time, whether that's CBT or talking therapies. This will in turn improve the support being provided to people seeking help for their mental health and reduce GPs' workload. Increasing the number of community link workers in general practice will hopefully improve engagement with social prescribing, the mental health benefits of which are well known. In Lanarkshire and my region, the well-connected social prescribing programme has been shown to help people by improving self-confidence and self-esteem, reducing low mood and feelings of stress, helping people develop positive ways of coping with the challenges of life, amongst other benefits. A scheme run over 5 months recently saw GPs at 5 practices in Edinburgh prescribing nature as part of a collaboration between RSPB Scotland and Edinburgh and Lothian's Health Foundation. This aimed to establish the effectiveness using nature as a health tool in an urban setting, with a review to rolling it out to other practices. And given that many peer support groups were cancelled due to not being able to meet in person during lockdown, outdoor social prescribing must be in the mix going forward. Great work is being done on social prescribing and the benefits are being felt. We know, however, that clinicians may struggle to find the time to engage with social prescribing and to develop relationships with local organisations. Community link workers will be vital in this regard, as they're able to spend extended lengths of time with patients. Link workers can build relationships of trust and signpost patients to appropriate local non-NHS services. Due to the pressures of the pandemic, however, many non-NHS organisations may be providing limited or reduced support. That's why it's essential that we support these organisations during the recovery from the pandemic and ensure there is equal access to social prescribing across the country. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Russell Findlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Prior to the pandemic, there was already an increasing demand for mental health services in Scotland, and we know that this increase in mental health demand has been exacerbated by the pandemic. COVID-19 has changed many aspects of our lives. The pandemic has allowed for a far greater understanding of the need to take mental health seriously and of having a society which puts the well-being of its citizens first and foremost. Presiding Officer, these exacerbated mental health challenges have shown the need for greater emphasis on mental health services and have created a need for improved service delivery, including through better integration with primary care and indeed the third sector. I welcome that significant progress has already been made by the Scottish Government in expanding capacity and access to mental health services in GP settings. Action 15 of the Mental Health Strategy 2017 to 2027 outlines the Scottish Government's commitment to funding 800 additional mental health workers in key settings, GP practices, all A&Es, every police station, custody suite and prisons. As of July 1, 2021, an additional 654.3 full-time equivalent mental health roles have been filled using Action 15 funding. This equates to 82% of the total overall target. The Scottish Government have made over £51 million available since 2019 to deliver Action 15, and will continue to invest in 2022 to ensure the commitment is met. In addition, it is welcome that the Scottish Government has invested over £60 million to create provisions for local authorities across Scotland to employ mental health counsellors. And I want to credit Dumfries and Galloway Council, who have really taken this initiative on board. The local authority has named their counsellor staff youth information officers. The name youth information officer is aimed to reduce stigma, which is hugely important, and the staff work directly as part of Dumfries and Galloway Youth Inquiry Team, accessing schools and young people across the region Monday as well as all the way through to Saturday. The staff are also delivering strong links with local primary care and NHS staff, and they are responding to new demands exacerbated by the pandemic. I welcome that these youth information officers and the Scottish Government have provided additional funding and support for crucial mental health services. Since March 2020, over £18 million of dedicated funding to help respond to the special mental health challenges of the pandemic has been allocated. And I'm really pleased that the Government have supported the mental health and wellbeing of our frontline health and social care staff. During the pandemic, I have continued to work as a registered nurse, and I've had contact directly with many health professional colleagues who have said that they have been really resilient, but some of them have also suffered from stress and real challenges, so that the money for the frontline healthcare workers to help their health and wellbeing is really, really welcome and important. Over £1 million has already been invested also in the rollout of Distress Brief Intervention Programme on a national basis, including to people under 18 as well. And DBI includes seeing trained frontline health, police, paramedic and primary care staff, they're trained in mental health first aid response. The DBI programme is hugely important and demonstrates how different agencies can work in partnership with primary care. DBI has already been accessed by over 4,000 individuals in the NHS 24 pathway, but I know many, many more have already been involved. And it is proven to support people particularly at risk of acute mental ill health, but including people struggling with eating disorders. We just heard at Health Committee yesterday and previously in the Mental Health Cross-Party Group, which I'm a co-convener of, that there are really an increase in concerns of people with eating disorders during the pandemic. But I also have concerns over the number of suicides and also the reports of persons who self-harm. The COVID restrictions have prevented face-to-face engagement, but I need to ask the Minister to ensure that DBI, as well as other online cognitive behavioural therapies, all that support continues to receive the funding that it's needed to move forward. My final point, Presiding Officer, is related to social prescribing. A large part of the Scottish Government's revised vision for mental health focuses on the importance of social prescribing and on the third sector playing a crucial role in promoting positive health and wellbeing. As a member of the Health and Sport Committee in this and the previous parliamentary session, one of the previous challenges which we recognised was primary care practitioners do not know which services are available to refer people to or to signpost people to. This was raised at committee just yesterday as well in our current child and adolescent mental health inquiry. There is support available and signposting people is vitally important. And third sector Dumfries and Galloway have created a website with an app called DG Locator to help signpost people to the services that are available. The DG Locator is similar to the government's ALIS service, which is a local information system for Scotland. But DG Locator is easy to navigate, it's up to date, and it has all the local services easy to access. And this has been linked with the GP practices across Dumfries and Galloway to make it easier for link workers and support to be signposted for people. So I would ask the Minister if he would consider checking
Ms. Harper.
DG Locator website.
Ms Harper, could I ask that you conclude your remarks, please?
Yes, I'm in my final sentence, Presiding Officer. I would just like to ask that the Minister would have a look at DG Locator and see how its functionality works. And I welcome the steps that the Government are taking forward, and I will conclude there, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Russell Finlay to be followed by Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As has already been said by the Minister and others, this is a subject with broad cross-party agreement. No one can doubt the importance of improving capability and capacity for mental health treatment. As we emerge from the darkness of the pandemic, these needs have never been more critical. It's a privilege to have Dr. Sandesh Gulhani as a colleague. His experience benefits our Parliament, and I look forward to hearing his contribution. GPs, like Dr Gulhani, are often the first point of contact for those with mental health problems. I know, because I have been that patient. I have sat in front of a GP and said that I was struggling. Those were dark days, and I found it difficult. But it was the right thing to do, and ultimately resulted in me getting the help that I needed. I was fortunate, as my employers paid for my treatment, but for many other people, are left in agonising limbo. In 2015, the SNP government introduced a target time for psychological treatment. It's a target that has never been met. Less than a year ago, the Royal College of Psychiatrists warned that child mental health services in Scotland were significantly underfunded, while an earlier Audit Scotland report said they were complex and fragmented. Mental health, like physical health, is not a constant throughout our lives. The Scottish Health Survey tells us that every year, around 1 in 4 are estimated to be affected by mental health problems. No one, absolutely no one, is immune from becoming unwell. I'm sure that many other members will have their own stories to tell, and it is important that we do so. The mindset of putting on a stiff upper lip and pulling yourself together now sounds ludicrously callous and old-fashioned. Charities such as the Scottish Association for Mental Health play a key role in chipping away at that stigma. Their campaign, See Me Scotland, can take credit for helping to change perceptions about mental health. In just over 3 weeks' time, on 3rd of February, they will run the Scottish part of the UK-wide Time to Talk Day. Described as the nation's biggest mental health conversation, it encourages friends and families, communities and colleagues to come together to talk, to listen and to change lives. But it won't just change lives, it will save lives. Another charity, the Samaritans, collates data on suicides from across the UK. These paint a very bleak picture. In England and Wales, the suicide rate is around 10 people per 100,000, while in Scotland it is 15 per 100,000. Last year, tragically, 805 people in Scotland could see no other way. Men are almost 3 times as likely as women to take their own lives, and people in the most deprived communities are also 3 times more likely to die by suicide than those in the most affluent areas. Numbers like these are sobering, but they cannot even begin to describe the pain behind each death. The need to talk is especially important for men who still, speaking generally, are not always as forthcoming about their struggles. Suicide is an emotive and complex subject. 6 minutes is nowhere near enough to provide a proper, meaningful contribution. But one issue I think that is overlooked is the role of the media. Research shows that explicit descriptions of suicide methods used, sensationalism, or identifying so-called hotspots can lead to imitational suicidal behaviour among vulnerable people. Broadcasters and newspapers adhere to detailed guidelines issued by media regulators and charities. Year-round, we see reports of missing people. All too often, there is a follow-up report of a body being found. There are no suspicious circumstances, say the police, which is usually coded language for suicide. However, these reports rarely ever mention the actual word. I believe this is motivated by a sensitivity and respect for the person whose life has been lost, and fears that a report could lead to further deaths. But does this well-intentioned blind spot not run contrary to the time to talk ethos? When someone dies of suicide, it should not be a taboo to say so. I would like to conclude with the observation, as has been made by others, that Scotland's mental health crisis predates the pandemic. Other speakers have provided numerous examples of delays and gaps in treatment and long-standing problems with staffing, morale and retention. Presiding officer, the SNP needs to stop producing long-winded reports and reviews, stop the self-congratulation, and get on with taking the necessary action to save lives. After almost 15 years in government, they can blame no one else. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Presiding officer, thank you very much. It was 22 years ago in 1999 that I finally managed to persuade the voters of Inverness, East Nairn and Lochaber to elect me. And I think it was really only after becoming an MSP that, perhaps to my shame, I realised that mental health was quite so prevalent amongst our community. And I think we see that across parties in the work that we do in our constituencies. And these problems, I think, are especially severe in the Highlands and Islands. And across all parties, I know that many have worked for many years to address what are complex and very difficult problems. And I think it'd be fair to mention the work of my former colleague, Mary Scanlon, who focused on this for many a year. So I would like to start by thanking all of those who work in our NHS, but also in other areas and functions, in our local authorities, our schools, the third sector, has been mentioned by Emma Harper and others, for all the work that they do, which is extremely difficult. I don't think I could do it. And it's immensely difficult to turn around the life of even one person who is troubled severely by mental health issues. And I'd like to welcome the very clear commitments of finance that have been made by the Minister. I must admit, I think some of the criticism about self-congratulation is just over the top. I don't see that. I see a Minister who is determined to do his best in a very challenging brief. I would also say that the schools play a very big role here. And I don't think this has been mentioned before, so this is the first of two points I wish to make, Presiding Officer. After all, young people in particular, especially in their teenage years, are slow to trust people, perhaps in particular female teenagers. And who are they more likely to trust, surely, than a teacher with whom they're close, a classroom assistant, an occupational therapist, a speech therapist? I understand from Shirley-Ann Somerville in the Education Committee this morning that counsellors are to be provided in each high school. I'm not sure what stage this initiative has reached, but I do think that early intervention is key. And I'd be interested if the Minister agrees, because he will know much more about this than I do, about what greater role schools can play, because, after all, they are looking to improve the mental health and well-being of all pupils within their care. So I think it's especially important that the role and the further potential role of schools is important, because if these problems can be tackled at an early stage before they become acute, then it doesn't get to the tragic stage that was described by Mr. Findlay and many others. The other issue I want to raise is one which arose following a fairly lengthy Zoom call with a family yesterday within my constituency who have a child who has been placed in care in what's called out-of-area care. And as the Minister knows, this involves persons with assessed acute mental health needs who require inpatient care, who are admitted to a unit out with their own local area. And this is a particular challenge for the Highlands, where there is a lack of specialist units of some varieties. And therefore, very often children, young children, teenagers require to be admitted to establishments in Glasgow or Dundee or Edinburgh. And that then means that the parents and family have to travel sometimes twice a week. In this particular case, the family have spent the best part of a year in twice weekly journeys of 370 miles to and from Glasgow. And I do think that the Minister may wish to look at how these arrangements operate. Because firstly, there is often very grave difficulty in accessing these services. The perception is, I'm afraid, that financial motivations may trump clinical judgment. Secondly, that there is unnecessary complexity and indeed, I believe, unnecessary references to mental health tribunals, which are incredibly costly, but also the source of huge conflict and tension amongst everybody involved. And thirdly, there is a very niggardly approach towards costs. Let me, in the closing parts of my speech, just just to advise the Chamber of what the costs are. This family, fortunately, in good remuneration, good remunerated employment, well remunerated employment, receive £8.50 each per day for meals allowance and a mileage allowance of 12 or 13p a mile. This family have travelled 30,000 miles in the last 10 months. 12p. Presiding Officer, we receive 45p a mile for the first 10,000 miles we travel. How can it conceivably be fair or justified that people who are in the desperately difficult situation of having a child who faces difficulties such as self-harm, such as Asperger's syndrome, and other such matters, should then have those difficulties compounded by being penalised financially in this way? So, also in closing, I will write with more details of this case, which I've chosen not to mention in this chamber for obvious reasons. I hope to meet with the Minister to discuss this case, and I think perhaps it casts a light into how the out-of-area service might be improved. But I would finish by stating what that family told me, that they are immensely grateful to many of the professionals in Scotland who have sought to help their child. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Pauline McNeill, who will be the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you. Many mental health practitioners will tell you that long periods of isolation, a lack of social contact, has inevitably had an effect on many people's mental health. That's what they hear in their sessions. But it starts when it comes to children and young people. And the pandemic and repeated lockdowns have been traumatic for children, with months away from school, separation from friends and anxiety about the virus itself, as well as concerns about their future job prospects. The ages of 19 to 25 is considered to be the most critical age in a person's life where they make life choices, and I think we have to factor that in to the services that we provide. We're already starting to talk about a lockdown generation, so we need to prepare our support services for that reality. And sadly, we know that the mental health crisis was with us before the pandemic. One example, Craig Hoy talked about this earlier on, is the experience of young girls on social media and a recent survey showing that 3 out of 5 girls had complained of some form of sexual harassment. Indeed, there is an urgency about setting out a comprehensive response and the creation of a mental health system which is fit for purpose with longer-term thinking and funding and support. The pandemic has also highlighted the deep inequalities in our society, and we must be mindful of that to support children and families. All children must be given the same chance to reach their own individual potential, but in order for that to happen, we need to do more to level up that opportunity so that our ambitions for them in school and education must be accompanied by strong action, such as one-to-one help and on skills and support in education. Many studies have shown that children and young people living in poverty, I think James Dornan mentioned this already, experience a greater impact on their mental health and also their educational attainment. Catherine Seymour, Head of Research at Mental Health Foundation, said our evidence indicates that teenagers from less advantaged homes are having the hardest emotional struggle of all, and they are much more likely to report frequent symptoms of anxiety and depression than their peers with parents in jobs that are typically better paid. But how do we know that young people are getting the support that they need? How easy is it to access support they need? How easy is it to access the right type of support? I suggest that it isn't always, and there are quite serious issues of young people struggling to get the support that they need. I've raised before. Many young people I have dealt with, worryingly, being bumped off the referral system for reasons that seem very thin to me. And I'm wondering, is this due to pressures on the service or not? Surely a system like that must factor in that if a young person cannot respond to a letter or a call because they need a mental health service, then surely bumping them off for not responding to a call or a letter is fundamentally the opposite of what the service should be doing. I've raised before. In Glasgow, there's an opt-in service. If you don't reply to the letter within 5 days, you can be removed from the referral system. I don't really understand the model of care. I've now spoken three times in this whole debate around mental health, and I would want the ministers to address the question of the structure of our mental health service and the quality of it. In many other areas, we do differentiate between young people up to the age of 25 and adults. However, for some reason in the health service, we haven't, although we've strived to get that transitional service. And I think that's really important when it comes to mental health, because the shift from childhood to adulthood is a sharp one. So we need a service that recognises this by design. I welcome the government's commitment to extend the CAMHS programme up to the age of 25. However, I am concerned about the high rate of referrals which are rejected. A figure that I found today suggested that 27% reject. I don't really know what this figure actually means, but I think we should interrogate that a bit more closely. I also believe that we need to make sure we're keeping up with the most recent treatments and that our system is not only a medical model. Many practitioners do not label patients with a specific diagnosis, so they get the specific help that they need. And I'm wondering, is this the approach that we have? Have we modernised enough as a service? And I certainly think a one-size-fits-all approach is certainly not what we need. We need to offer options that suit the patients as well. SMH say that 46% of respondents support options for their depression. So that suggests that people should have some kind of choice. I think Gillian Mackay spoke about this earlier as well. I was concerned to find out that a case that I raised in the debate last year of a young woman who made a suicide attempt was not a priority in the system for reasons I could not understand. And after several interventions from the GP and from me as her MSP, finally got an appointment with a psychiatrist. And because she needed or required DBT treatment as opposed to CBT treatment, she was told that it's not available on our NHS mental health services. And that has led me to question whether or not we are too focused on CBT or singular therapies, where I'm clear in my own mind it's common sense that we should incorporate treatments that would widen. I can't see. Am I past my 6 minutes? Can't see the clock.
You have some 20 plus seconds, Ms McNeill.
And my 20 seconds remaining. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll sit a bit closer next time. I do think I would really like the Minister to address the question of the modernisation of our services. Have we done enough research to satisfy us? It's not just about waiting lists and just about resources, but we need to make sure that Scotland as a nation is modernising a service which is fit for purpose, because if we do not do this, all the discussion and critique around waiting lists, I think, will be less significant. We need to address this question. If I could just conclude by saying that the Barnardo's chief executive, Javed Khan, put it very well when he said the negative effects of the pandemic could last a lifetime if children and young people don't have the right support. Children must be front and centre of the government's plans for the post-COVID period. I hope some of my points can be addressed in the summing up. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do reiterate my thanks to the government benches for bringing this debate so early in this new year, in this parliamentary term. But I should correct the Minister. I think it's not fair for him to say that mental health has been a priority for the SNP since 2007. It has not. For many years, it was Liberal Democrats leading debates on mental health in this chamber that gave it the only airtime it got. Again, the spending that was afforded in Scottish budgets to mental ill health was because Liberal Democrats had asked for it. So it's disingenuous to say it's been a priority when it was only a Liberal Democrat called for a Minister for Mental Health that had one created. I'll cover some of the topics and points raised by other members and then address some specifics within the strategies. If I may, Presiding Officer Karen Mochan, I thought, delivered an excellent speech and was right again to talk about how we wouldn't leave people with a severe physical injury for want of care for an entire year. But that's what we're asking people to do with severe mental injuries every day, week in, week out. We also support Labour's call in their amendment for dedicated mental health professionals in GP surgeries. It's something we have been calling for many years. Link workers are fine, but they're only as fine as the referrals they can make. And if you're referring somebody to the end of one of the longest waiting lists in the NHS, it is of no use to you if you are in a moment of profound personal crisis. James Dornan, I have some respect for James Dornan taking up his own mental health record. I think anyone who does so in this chamber is incredibly brave. Yet he diminished that contribution, and he diminished himself when he launched a series of childish attacks. He could have taken a leaf, I think, out of Fergus Ewing's book, who spoke with even-handed fortitude and paid credit rightly to many members right across the chamber in their efforts around this important issue. Sue Webber, I think, made a couple of important points about employment, and we picked that up in our Freedom of Information request when we discovered over Christmas time that last year over 400 years of staff time was lost to the nursing profession alone last year because of mental ill health. This has a massive impact on staffing capacity and indeed well-being, and that is self-sustaining, because if you're having to cover the work of a shift that is no longer safely staffed, that will have an impact on your own well-being. I want to come to some of the work that the government is doing, and in particular I have an interest in Action 15 highlighted in the government's motion today, and that's because Scottish Liberal Democrats won this commitment and have had to press again and again for the government to keep it and be open about progress. I remember meeting the then Health Secretary Shona Robertson and Mental Health Minister Maureen Watt shortly after I was first elected in 2016. I impressed upon them the importance of getting an army of mental health practitioners into four key settings. That's A&Es, GP surgeries, prisons, and working alongside the police in the community. So it was, I was very pleased when I heard when a version of our manifesto commitment was included in the 2017 mental health strategy, albeit on a scale that I warned wouldn't make the impact needed. We told ministers it needed 2,000 staff to truly offer new 24/7 provision, but only 800 were offered. They weren't practitioners, they were link workers. That was never enough. Take the police. Police officers and staff deal with people in distress on a daily basis. They do so knowing that other services are better placed to help. But the police are all too often the service of last resort. And the latest Action 15 update shows that Police Scotland receiving just 20 extra staff. That's less than one extra mental health worker for every 1,000 officers and staff. That's not transformational, and every single one of those 1,000 officers and staff will tell you that. They deal with mental health on a daily basis. It's a huge proportion of what they do, and they need more support. 800 new mental health staff was never enough to meet the unmet demand, and that's before these key settings received less than they were originally promised. A third of the staff that were hired under Action 15 have been diverted to so-called, quote, other settings, and for years the government could tell us virtually nothing about who they were and what they were doing. Worse still, they find themselves against releasing information around recruitment towards Action 15. For 2 years, ministers argued against releasing Action 15 recruitment projections, including detail about where staff will be located and the roles into which they were being recruited. It needed us to go all the way to the Information Commissioner, who concluded recently that withholding this information is indeed a breach of the Freedom of Information Act 2002 and ordered its disclosure. Scottish Liberal Democrats want to work with this Scottish Government where we can. The very existence of Action 15 and £120 million more mental health for mental health this year are some of the fruits of our previous work. And I am determined to see many more mental health staff recruited in this Parliament. But ministers make that task harder. The job of ending the terrible long waits for treatment if they refuse to release just basic information. We shouldn't need a 2-year battle and are going all the way to the Information Commissioner to find out how £35 million is really being spent. We've only just started to learn more about the staff in so-called other settings and the extent to which their time is actually spent in A&Es, GPs, prisons and alongside police in our community, as I said, were the priority areas. So I want to know if the government is counting them as progress towards this flagship target, even if it only represents a fraction of their job. I hope that the Cabinet Secretary can address that when summing up. Otherwise, there are absolutely no guarantees that A&E departments, GP practices, prisons and the police are getting anywhere near the benefit of the full contingent of additional mental health workers that they expected when this commitment was unveiled in 2017. I can see my time is up, Presiding Officer, but I do think it's important the Cabinet Secretary address that in summation. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Jackie Bailey. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The importance of this debate cannot be overemphasised, and many of the contributions across the Chamber have been both thoughtful and challenging. I want to commend in particular Russell Finlay for his contribution on suicides, which was very powerful indeed. Let me start by saying that mental health is something that affects us all, and Scottish Labour is willing to work constructively with this government and parties across this chamber to end this continuing crisis in mental health and get help to those most in need. I welcome much of what the Minister said, including community link workers, but there is little recognition of the current poor state of provision, and the SNP have been in charge for almost 15 years. As we have all acknowledged, the pandemic has had a devastating impact on our mental health. From an individual perspective, not being able to go to work, to visit friends and family, not being able to access vital face-to-face mental health and support services has all had an impact on our well-being. So too, the mental health challenges faced by health and social care staff who have been at the very front line of the pandemic and cared for and been with those dying throughout that time. But the Minister knows Scotland's mental health crisis far predates the pandemic. While the steps that the government have laid out today are welcome, it is nevertheless deeply disappointing that they are not on the scale required to tackle the problem. And if their track record is anything to go by, previous promises to tackle the crisis in mental health have simply not been met. Primary care is truly the front line of mental health care, with many people going to their GP surgeries as their first port of call when experiencing mental ill health. But we know that GP practices have been overwhelmed with the increase in patient numbers, so access to dedicated mental health clinicians will help to ease the significant pressure that GPs are facing. Hand in hand with the need for additional clinicians is the need for primary care-based mental health services to be made available 24/7. Because we know that mental ill health doesn't only operate on a 9-to-5, Monday-to-Friday basis. In my area, half of my constituents, covered by NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, have access to out-of-hours mental health crisis services. But if you live in Helensburgh and Lomond, part of NHS Highland, there is nothing after 8 p.m. That postcode lottery cannot be allowed to continue. As Carol Mockin has pointed out, severe and long-lasting staff shortages in mental health services undermine any efforts that those within primary care settings are making to improve service delivery. It is deeply disappointing that despite promises made by the government in 2017 to recruit 800 additional mental health workers in key settings over the next 5 years, including in GP practices, latest figures show that we are still at least 100 key workers short of meeting this target. 71% of Royal College of GP members said that they saw a significant increase in the number of patients presenting with mental health needs as a result of the pandemic. And that speaks to the urgent need for an immediate increase in staffing numbers, as well as a long-term workforce strategy to address these problems. The RCN made it clear that no amount of service redesign or additional funding will improve services while so many mental health nursing posts remain unfilled. The vacancies within mental health nursing are at an all-time high. Over 1,000 positions left unfilled. So any pledge to increase staffing levels must first fill existing gaps and then create roles that are genuinely additional. The SNP's government's promise of 150 additional mental health student places is welcome. But, you know, it doesn't begin to touch the sides and will not provide the fix that the workforce crisis needs. The Royal College of Psychiatrists have made clear that while any commitment to addressing the crisis within the workforce is welcome, there needs to be far more detail on what shape this will take. To tackle the current postcode lottery that exists within mental health service provision, the Royal College of Psychiatrists is calling for clarity on training pathways and a shared understanding of what success looks like in terms of mental ill health. There is no point, they say, in pledging to create X number of additional staff if we then don't have a proper strategy of where these workers are best placed to be of most use. And as Carol Mockin pointed out, nowhere is the postcode lottery more apparent than the provision of the CAM service. There are a staggering 12,000 children and young people on CAMHS waiting lists at the end of September 2021. Almost 2,000 of them have waited over a year. Just imagine the agony for them and their families desperately waiting for help. And as Craig Hoy said, the 18-week target time for CAMHS has never been met. And that is shameful, and there is no two ways about it. I was recently contacted by a mother who told me how her daughter, who is in need of outpatient CAMHS support to tackle the beginnings of an eating disorder, had been left to deteriorate on a waiting list for so long that she has now had to be admitted to long-term inpatient care. That would have been entirely avoidable had she been able to access the care that she needed in a timely manner. Presiding officer, let me finish by saying, you know, I wish the current minister well in his endeavours, and we will work with him and others across the chamber. But I hope he will recognise the considerable frustration of members that his predecessor SNP ministers have simply not served mental health services well.
Thank you. I call on Sandesh Gulhani, up to 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I started to read the Minister's motion, my eyes lit up. Yes, I believe as Scotland recovers from COVID-19 pandemic that members indeed recognise the importance of improving within primary care settings, capability and capacity for mental health assessment, care and support. But then my heart sank. The Minister goes on to say that progress has already been made to boost capacity in GP settings. Really? I guess this depends on how the SNP defines progress. Or maybe it's down to the cherry-picking the data to suit a desired narrative. Presiding Officer, I wish to declare my interest as a GP, and I have also worked in psychiatry. And based upon my own experience and that of the Royal College of Nursing Scotland, please allow me to describe the reality in primary care. When it comes to the Scottish Government's stewardship of mental health services, there is no place for self-congratulatory statements. There is clear evidence that mental health services have been struggling for a long time. The national standard, that is 90% of people referred for psychological therapy, should start within 18 weeks, as mentioned by many of my colleagues. However, this standard has not been met. But why is this so important? Imagine you are 20 minutes late to a job interview and you're rushing to get there. In that moment, you're scared, worried and anxious. Now imagine having that feeling all the time. Imagine being at work and making a mistake and being told off. In that moment, you feel ashamed that nobody likes you. You feel down. Now imagine having that feeling all the time. People do not choose to have mental health issues. It does not respect wealth, job title, name. And I've only described the mild to moderate end of the mental health scale here. If you break your arm and it's off at an angle, people can see it and you are treated. But mental health does not have anything that you can see. It's a disease that deserves to be treated and taken care of just as much as any physical injury. The majority of my GP day on Monday felt like it was taken up with mental health issues, and we have to do better than this. And regarding child and adolescent CAM services, as Alex Cole-Hamilton and others have told us, more than 20% of young people wait more than 18 weeks to access CAMHS treatment. And the 90% national standard has never been met. And this is mainly down to abysmally poor workforce planning. Mental health nursing vacancies have been rising for the past 5 years and are currently at record levels with over 1,000 posts unfilled, an increase of 350 unfilled posts in the last year. I would like to thank Russell Findlay for bravely talking about his own mental health problems. Speaking up is absolutely vital. Stigma is worse for men and in the ethnic communities. We must work harder to remove stigma, and I also agree with him that media can help in this endeavour. I can definitely tell Fergus Ewing that early intervention is indeed key, and further, that schools have a pivotal role to play. And I agree with him that the financial penalisation of the family he described is unacceptable, and patients out of area or children who are being moved around in the care setting are at risk. Pauline McNeill spoke about the role of social media. During lockdown and restrictions, a lot of us took to social media. We saw the glamorous lifestyle of celebrity, the rich, and the highlights of other people's lives and compared it to ours, the fantasy that we see on social media, and this has worsened mental health problems. And 20% rejection, I can tell again, Pauline McNeill, that basically this means that I, as a GP, will need to pick up the care of these patients. My colleague Sue Webber has said that mental health issues were the primary reason for time off work, and that this is likely as a combination of lockdown, restrictions, and as Craig Hoy has so articulately say, people are twice as likely to experience anxiety, depression, and high levels of psychological distress following COVID. We are very stretched in GP, and patients return to us because they face long waits to be seen in hospital, and that adds to that burden. Sue Webber spoke about Mary Glasgow, who appeared before us in the Health Committee, and her idea of having family wellbeing teams across the country from successful pilots is right, and hearing Joe Fitzpatrick's great examples strengthens this ask. We need to help those with low-level mental health issues, not with drugs or psychiatry, but support in the community. Russell Findlay also spoke eloquently about the fact that poor mental health leads to the sad reality of people committing suicide. He is right in saying men are more likely to die because they tend to have more violent attempts at suicide, but more women attempt suicide. This is a cry for help. This is an agonised person's last desperate act. And for anyone who's watching this, if you feel low, if you feel sad, if you feel like things are getting on top of you and the dark is closing in, please pick up the phone. Call the Samaritans, 116 123. That's 116 123. Call your GP. Speak to your family or friends. Speaking about how you feel is the first step to getting better. The SNP must accept that we went into this pandemic with a pre-existing mental health crisis that was exacerbated, not solely caused by COVID. And I think Monica Lennon agrees with me with this. The key to addressing the mental health crisis in primary care is sustainable workforce planning. And an apt example of this is NHS Lanarkshire, that has put GP services under managed suspension and will focus only upon the most urgent and critical care. Let me explain why this is such a bad thing to happen. When A&E asks patients not to come in unless it's life-threatening, it is GPs that provide the safety net to catch those sick patients who did not attend. GPs provide unlimited care to patients and pick up so much incidental pathology. GPs ensure not only the health but the well-being of patients is looked after. Back pain, urine infections, period issues, endometriosis, as discussed yesterday, do not fulfil the definition. But if you suffer from these issues, it is urgent. GP service in Lanarkshire has broken. My fellow GPs and everyone working in primary care has seen so much extra work from hospital that we are burning out. Patients will suffer. NHS Lanarkshire needs to be escalated to level 5, and I hope the Cabinet Minister will address this in his closing remarks. The Minister's motion misses the mark. Scotland doesn't need another statement of intent. If members are serious about mental health and wellbeing in primary care settings, they'll support our amended motion, one with substance and commitment. To ensure the health and wellbeing of our patients, we must take care of the health and wellbeing of our workforce. You can't have one without the other.
Thank you. I call on Hamza Youssef to wind up. Up to 9 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Happy New Year to you, Presiding Officer, and to, of course, all members across the Chamber. Can I say this has been, well, I think it has been an excellent debate right across the Chamber. I haven't agreed with every single word that has been said, and it never will be the case, I suspect, but it has been a very powerful debate. Many members have mentioned, particularly those who have been in this Chamber and in this Parliament for a number of years now, that actually this Parliament is at its best in discussing this issue when it comes together. And there has been good examples of collaboration, some of which I will touch upon if I can during my contribution. I want to first of all thank members who have spoken about their constituents. I think every single one of us will have had constituents contacting our offices, contacting us at our surgeries in really dire circumstances and in really difficult situations. And I don't doubt for a second that every single MSP right across this chamber will deal with those issues with the utmost compassion and also with the urgency that those situations require. But I really want to pay tribute to those who have referenced constituent cases. And a number of people have said they might write to myself or indeed to Kevin Stewart, and we'd urge you to do so. And of course, Kevin and I would be happy to meet with MSPs in relation to any issues that they raise. I also want to thank Russell Findlay for sharing his own story and his own speaking about his own mental health challenges. He did so powerfully. He also made the important point that it is, you know, speaking up in the positions that we have with the platform that we have is really important to destigmatise, to remove the taboo of mental health, particularly, if I may say, of men, I think, of a certain age where we know suicide is far higher than their female counterparts. So I want to congratulate and thank him more so, I should say, for speaking up. A number of good contributions, and many of them touched on very common themes, which I will try to pick up. Craig Hoy, in his contribution, talked about and challenged government, I think rightly, but all of us, to demystify and de-jargonise the services. And I think he's right to reference that. I think government and our documents and our strategies and articulation of the services that exist perhaps fall into that trap of jargonising them. So I take up the challenge, but I would say also that the 1,000 additional mental health professionals and GP practices that are in the hearts of our communities will help us in that endeavour. I know that from an excellent community link worker we have in Pollock Health Centre, who actually has just moved on but replaced by an equally good community link worker. They have the ability to really be in a level with our constituents, with the public, and give them access to services in a way perhaps that, he's right, government can sometimes suggest that those services are a bit more inaccessible than they are. So I take up his challenge on that, and certainly in the work that we do, we'll make sure that we make those services as accessible as possible. In terms of some of the key themes that were mentioned by a number of members across this chamber, one of those was on workforce, and of course a number of the motions reference workforce and workforce challenges. I do accept absolutely that there were challenges pre-pandemic. There seemed to be a suggestion from some members that we don't accept that there were challenges. In fact, I've stood up in this chamber on countless occasions to say that I accept fully that there were challenges pre-pandemic. Equally, I would ask for some acknowledgement back from the opposition that the pandemic over the last 21, 22 months has undoubtedly been a significant, significant shock to our health services and indeed a significant shock to people's individual mental health. The amount of constituents that have come to me who have said they've never suffered a mental health challenge until the pandemic it actually was quite staggering in itself. So I'm not suggesting there have not been challenges pre-pandemic. But equally, I would like to say there has been improvement under the course and stewardship of this government since 2006. CAM staff have increased by 81%. The psychology workforce has increased by 110%. Of course, we've since 2007, we are planning for an additional 320 CAM staff to be recruited, increasing our nursing mental health intake, which I know was an issue raised by a number of colleagues in terms of the vacancies that exist. But we are working hard to increase our mental health nursing workforce in NHS Scotland. Has increased by 34% to over 9,500, in fact 9,700 whole-time equivalent posts. But I accept that there are still challenges, and therefore the mental health nursing student intake will increase in 22-23 to a recommended intake of 888 places. That's up 20% from the previous year, and that's actually up almost 150% over the course of the last 10 student uptake. So we do take those workforce challenges seriously. Some members asked us how did we compare with the rest of the UK, and we of course look to work where there's best practice elsewhere in the UK. We will look to see where we can possibly match that. But I would say in a recent benchmarking, shortly I will, on a number of a recent benchmarking study that looked at mental health services across the UK, we had 56 full-time equivalents per 100,000 compared to the average UK average of 40 full-time equivalents. I will give away to Pauline McNeill.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary would address the issue that was the theme of my speech, with investment and a priority, which the government says it clearly is. How would you satisfy yourself that Scotland's system is not only compared with the UK, but is compared internationally in terms of how we provide services, making sure that they have the optimum treatments and that the variation of treatments are available. How do ministers satisfy themselves that the investment, if you like, you're putting in is going to result in an internationally brilliant service?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a very fair challenge. I would say that when it comes to the government and it comes to our officials and ministers, we do not just look UK-wide, we look European-wide, we look globally. But what I would say, and this is a fair challenge that Pauline McNeill put back to the government, is the first step in that is, of course, ensuring that we meet the targets that we have set ourselves. And members have criticised the government for not reaching that 96% target. I don't blame them for doing so. It is from my perspective, we are, although making progress, and the latest figures show that 78.6, almost 8 out of 10 children and young people were met within that target time, that 18-week target time. That's not the 90% we committed to. So members are right to challenge us on that, and I give you every commitment that Kevin Stewart and I and the entire government do not sit on rest on our laurels on this. We are not complacent about this. We want to make sure that we reach that target. The other key theme that was mentioned by a number of members was that investment in areas of deprivation, but also in areas where that those waiting times are not being met, and are not just not being met, but actually are the lowest and the furthest away from being met. And I wanted to give an absolute assurance that in the government, we are looking to invest specifically in targeting those health board areas where they're the furthest away from meeting that target. So an additional £40 million has gone in this financial year to that. In terms of funding itself, which of course is important, that has been referenced by Kevin Stewart already, we will increase funding for mental health by 25%. We'll ensure 10% of frontline NHS spend goes towards mental health. Just in the time that I have left, a number of good points were raised. I just wanted to give an absolute assurance that I think Alex Cole-Hamilton and a couple of other members who asked if the 1,000 mental health professionals in GP practices were in addition to Action 15. They are in addition to Action 15. There should be no doubt about that. But if he wants further clarification at any point, then I'm happy to provide that. I wanted to just sum up really by the important points raised by Monica Lennon and Gillian Mackay on NHS Lanarkshire. They asked me for some clarification about the change in GP services. Would that include mental health services? Yes, absolutely. Where NHS Lanarkshire have said they will see people who are critical and time critical and urgent, that doesn't just include physical health, it would also include mental health. And I should say, although the press release from NHS Lanarkshire has said that those arrangements will be in place for 4 weeks, I have made it clear that they should be reviewed every single week. I'm sorry, due to the shortage of time, I haven't been able to address other members' points, but I will write to a number of members around some of the questions that they have asked. But I hope that we can continue what was a really collaborative approach to tackling mental health, particularly for our young people and particularly for our children. This government will do everything we can to ensure that we have the appropriate service and provision available in every single part of the country to support all of those who are struggling with their mental health.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on mental health and wellbeing in primary care services. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 2757 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2757 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 2758 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motion.
And happy to do so, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and there are 5 questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Craig Hoy is agreed to, then the amendment in the name of Carol Mockin will fall. The first question is that Amendment 2747.3 in the name of Craig Hoy, which seeks to amend Motion 2747 in the name of Kevin Stewart on mental health and wellbeing in primary care services, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.